regular meeting of the town council. May we have the roll call, please, by the clerk?
Chairman Carson?
Here.
Counsel Barry?
Present.
Counsel Fritz?
Here.
Counsel Watson?
Here.
Counsel McGinty?
Here.
Counsel Roberts?
Here.
Counsel Swift Kayata?
Here.
Thank you. Now the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. I do have an award. Tom Emery was here at our last meeting, but we didn't have the plaques. But we have it this time.
Well, this is quicker than I expected in the agenda.
Well, we didn't want you to have to wait for the whole agenda unless you wanted to. On behalf of the town council and the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, Tom, I'd like you to present you with this plaque. This plaque really is not enough to thank Tom for the many committees that he has served on in this community. And this particular plaque is for the Town Farm Ordinance Committee and the Easement Drafting Committee. A difficult task for anybody. And we do want to thank you very much, and especially for all the citizens, for a job well done.
Thank you very much. I have a prepared statement. First, I'd like to say I'm particularly honored. It's not everyone who's invited twice to consecutive council meetings to receive awards, so I'm particularly honored. To be chair, one has to have a committee, and I'd like to thank the original committee members, Randy Blake, Phyllis Cogshell, Joe Groff, who just walked by, Don Evans, Pam McNally, and Jack Roberts, and also Bill Jordan and Peter Rand, and to all of the members of the public who attended all of the meetings that took quite some time. I feel particularly fortunate to have served on this committee as chair with such esteemed members of the town, and additionally because of the importance of this piece of property. This is probably the most important piece of open space in town, second only perhaps to Fort Williams, and uniquely different than Fort Williams. It will be up to the town to remain stewards for the future generations to enjoy this property. And I guess as a reminder, I know this item is on the agenda this evening, that we should all remember, I think it was probably lesson 101 in graduate school, that the view of the property is no more important than the view from the property in protecting a natural resource. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Tom. Reports and correspondence?
I'd like to remind everybody, Madam Chairman, that the Historical Preservation Committee will have a meeting on July 21st at 7 o'clock here in the Town Hall. And also, there is an incidence of ticks, and this is the season for ticks. I know Dr. Rand in the audience tonight. I know that he works with this area, and our dog on Two Lights Road has been bitten by a tick and contracted Lyme disease, which is very serious. And I understand that there's a child who was about 3 years old who was also infected by a tick. So I just want to bring to the attention of the community that they should examine their animals for ticks frequently during this tick season and make sure that they get them off.
Thank you.
And we'll see you at the Historical Preservation Committee on Thursday, July 21st, 7 o'clock.
Thank you. Anybody else? Ruth?
Madam Chair, I have been appointed to serve on the nominating committee of the Maine Municipal Association. And tomorrow I am going to Augusta to join about 8 other individuals to select 6 people to represent the Maine Municipal Association's executive committee and 5 people to represent their advisory group. So I was very flattered to be asked to serve on that committee, and we're looking for nominations, and we have quite a few people from all across the state to choose from. I'm very happy with our slate of people that will be serving in that capacity. And the other thing I wanted to mention is that at the end of May, a bill came before the legislature about curbing individual municipalities' rights to sue gun manufacturers. And the Maine, I serve on the Legislative Policy Committee for Cape Elizabeth. I received a call from the executive director of MMA asking me to put in a call to our legislators here in our area to ask them not to support this ban, not allowing municipalities to sue gun manufacturers, which I did. However, I have to report that the legislature approved this law. They passed a law forbidding municipalities to launch lawsuits against gun manufacturers. And I think it's something that we all need to be somewhat concerned about. Not so much for Maine, because you know our crimes are not as bad in this area as in other areas of the country. However, I think we've sent the wrong message to the National Rifle Association by saying that in Maine, we're not going to allow our municipalities to sue gun manufacturers, and it just gives them more clout in other areas. So, needless to say, I am disappointed that our representatives in our legislature voted to support this bill. But if it ever comes back up, I think it's something that we should all get behind. It does usurp our right as a town to sue manufacturers for guns in our community.
Thank you, Jack. Councilor Roberts.
Madam Chairwoman, a couple of weeks ago, I had the pleasure of standing in for yourself for the dedication of a trail across an easement that had been provided to the town as for a walking trail that connects Chancellor Gardens to the utility line that runs down through. It was attended by mostly the residents of the community there, but it does hook the neighborhoods in behind it, Elizabeth Park and Brentwood, into the different walkways that are developing. And I'm very pleased that Chancellor Gardens also seems to be receptive to being an ongoing partner in trying to work with us with different things we may need. And thank you for asking me to represent you.
You're welcome. I'm sure you did a great job.
Yes. Madam Chair, I just wanted to remind people, there's an advertisement coming out in the next Courier, but as chair of the Appointments Committee, I want to solicit people to apply for vacancies and positions on the town boards and commissions. There are two openings on the Arts Commission, two on the Recycling Committee, one on the Zoning Board of Appeals, and one opening for a trustee for the Thomas Memorial Library. If you're interested in serving, you can apply through the town website, or you can get an application from Barbara Ray at the town offices. Applications are due in July 30th, and I would encourage people to apply, since townspeople participating and volunteering in our town government is what makes it work so well. So thank you.
Thanks. Councilor McGinty.
I'd just like to remind everybody that the Fort Williams Centennial Celebration is in full swing this month. We had a concert yesterday at the fort. Our own Henry Berry will be performing with others next Sunday at the fort. And that July 24th is the big event. It's the big day that we're going to celebrate the centennial there. So remind everybody to get in the mood and come out and have some fun and celebrate the centennial of Fort Williams.
Thank you. Are there any other comments? We will move on to the town manager's report.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. First of all, I do want to mention that I think, as everyone on the, I know everyone on the council is aware, is that I wasn't here at the council meeting last month and was missing for a good part of the month. I really want to thank Deborah Lane for all of her work during my absence, as well as the department heads. Also, I think one of the biggest regrets I had in not being here last month was to have missed the funeral of John Civilly, who was such a great volunteer. And I had an opportunity to read Deborah's comments that she made at the council meeting, and I just think you know, her comments really captured him well. And I also, you know, I've spoken with a number of people who attended John's funeral, and really want to thank and acknowledge L.P. Murray, Jim Murray, and the fire chief for what I've heard were really exceptional comments that they made in honor of John Civilly. I spoke to some people who are in the funeral business, and said that that they had never heard nicer eulogies and saw a nicer service than there was for John Civilly, and that's a credit to those who spoke, and I think even more a credit to John Civilly, because he was such an exceptional person that one could say such great things about. So really want to thank Deborah for her efforts, and Jimmy, and the fire chief as well. Second, I don't want to get in the habit of talking about deaths every month, but we also had another citizen who you might not have noticed passed away this last month. And you might have noticed, but not in terms of the impact she had on Cape Elizabeth. Elsa West DeMillo, who lived on Pilot Point Road, back about 20 years ago, came into the town hall wanting a bikeway on Route 77, and was very concerned that there weren't any plans for it. She got, I think, 500 signatures of students and went up to Augusta and actually persuaded the Maine Department of Transportation to come in at no expense to the town of Cape Elizabeth and put a bikeway in from Bothell's Garage all the way out to the Nazarene Church. And that was, really the efforts of one person. And I know, while there's been some controversy about bikeways since, there's never been any regret at all that I've heard in the community about that improvement that was made to Route 77 as a result of Elsa's work and dedication. And she was a truly dedicated citizen and really had an impact on Cape Elizabeth, and wanted to acknowledge that. I did want to mention, because I know there's some concern about the council when we have special meetings, that the public might not be fully aware of. The town council did have a special meeting on June 29th, which they'll be reviewing the minutes this evening. It was at 8:15 in the morning, and it was I forget what day of the week, Monday morning, was it a Monday? Whatever day it was, all seven council members showed up at 8:15 a.m. in the morning for the sole purpose of considering an item of awarding the town's insurances the contract for the next year, actually for the next 3 years, for property casualty fleet insurance. As a result of the seven councilors coming that morning, we were able to accept a bid that saved the town $12,000, or about 25% over what we had been paying for insurance. So I do want to acknowledge that, one, the meeting occurred, and two, that it was really good savings to the community as a result. So beyond that, there are a number of projects going on, the Town Center project, and I really appreciate the citizens' patience with that. It has been trying at times, but I think we can see some pretty good progress on that. The pool project continues. It is continuing to run behind schedule, which is of concern, and we've been having weekly meetings every Thursday morning with the contractor, and they hope that they've finally turned the corner and that we'll start building instead of doing work in the ground. Which is where we've been at this point. But it's been a little bit frustrating, and we're very nervous about the end of November coming in the swim season. But we are working closely, but I did want to let you know. I always let you know the good things that are happening, and that is one thing that's not so good, is that the pool is currently running about 30 days behind schedule. So we really hope to begin to close that gap, but it does remain a concern. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any citizens' discussions of items that are not on the agenda? This is the time for them. Not hearing any, we will move on, please. To the council, in front of your seat this evening, the minutes were left out of our packet, and it is the time that we usually approve the minutes for the previous meeting, so you may decide which. Councilor McGinty.
I move that we table approving these minutes until we have a chance to review them, to table to the next meeting.
Second.
That's it. No discussion. All those in favor? Okay. That's easy. Fine. We will now move on to item 19, receipt of a report from the Planning Board recommending zoning ordinance amendments for a new town farm district, an amendment to the zoning map showing the proposed district. Is that you?
Yeah.
Henry, we're not ready yet. We're going to have a little discussion.
Yeah. These were originally came to the town council from the committee that was chaired by Tom Emery. The council at that point did two things. They recommended that this be referred to the planning board, to go through the planning board process. They also agreed at a workshop that they would discuss the balance of the committee report, which was to consider the option of having an easement placed on the property as well that would be held by a third party. The hope is that this item would be referred to the Ordinance Committee, as is the customary procedure, for the Ordinance Committee to review the details of it, to report back to the Council, and concurrently for the Town Council to hold a workshop that you had agreed to hold on the larger issue of whether or not you want to do an easement, and to come back to the town council, and then to have some citizen discussion on the advisability of doing that. Really, two separate issues, two separate processes, and, you know, I think in, you know, reviewing, I just saw the planning board minutes came in, saw them today from their last meeting at which they proposed this. You know, I think everyone does see the distinction that they are two separate issues, and that in moving forward with the ordinance, in no way removes the possibility of an easement, because, you know, all property is owned and has certain conditions and issues upon it, and all property has one type of zoning or another. So they are two distinct issues. So the recommendation, in keeping with normal council procedure, would be to refer this to the ordinance committee.
I would move that the proposed amendments be accepted and referred to the ordinance committee.
Second.
Thank you. Now, is there any more discussion on this item?
Madam Chair, my only discussion is I support the ordinance for this zoning. However, I want to be on the record to say I do not support an easement. We just spent a lot of money purchasing this property. I am not inclined to give it away to somebody else to manage. And I support the ordinance, but absolutely do not support an easement.
Thank you. I think you'll have an opportunity to discuss this more fully when it comes back from the ordinance committee, probably, too. Are there any more is there any more discussion at this time? If not, the motion is to move it on to the ordinance committee. All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Item number 20, consideration of a proposed bond resolution to borrow $2.2 million for the community pool project and $3.5 million for a new public works garage and other improvements on the Gullcrest property.
Yes, the council has in its packet this evening a draft bond resolution that was prepared by Bruce Cogsell, who has served for 25 or so years as Cape Elizabeth's bond counsel. The $2.2 million portion of the swimming pool is the amount that was approved by the voters roughly a year ago, and it is $2 million of a $2.7 million project. The public works portion is in keeping with all of the discussion up to now, in keeping with, obviously, I think everyone's aware, it was printed on the agenda, the council had a workshop this evening. It is in continuing with the plan that you saw more details this evening. This is a very key vote, because the plan would be to borrow the money sometime probably in late August. We're getting real tight with our cash flow because of the money we're laying out for the pool. You know, the only blessing about it going slower is that we haven't been laying out the money quite as quickly as we might have been, but that's a very short-term issue. But my hope is we could borrow this money late in August. That's the plan. You know, I won't go into details on the project. I think everyone's aware of them. And this is a standard bond resolution. If this is adopted this evening, within the purview of the charter, I should point out that the citizens do not vote on bond issues. The reason they voted on the pool is because it was connected to a school. Under our charter, citizens do not vote on it. However, if any citizen was at all opposed to this and was so inclined, they could circulate a petition, get 10% of the signature of the registered voters within 30 days, and force a citizen vote on it. There's no reason to anticipate that might happen, and we haven't heard any opposition. But I did want to point out that citizens do have the right to do this. So, you know, if this is approved this evening, we would not borrow and close on the money for at least 30 days in order to ensure that the citizens' right under the charter to intervene in this project would be protected.
Thank you. It would be appropriate at the top of the page of 20, where all the words that voted, the top phrase of each in the capital letters is adequate to be read for making a motion.
Madam Chairman, I will move that the Town Council authorize expenditure of $2.7 million for improvements and renovations to the Richards Pool and the issuance of $2.2 million in bonds to finance such expenditure.
We're going to do both.
It's up to the council. You want to do the...
Want to do both together?
Oh, all right.
It's the top of the set next.
I move to, that the town council vote to authorize expenditure of $3.5 million for construction, for constructing and equipping a new public works facility at the town's Gulf Press property on Spurwink Road and the issuance of $3.5 million in bonds to finance such expenditure.
Thank you. Do I hear a second? Discussion?
I'll second it for discussion.
Thank you. It's been moved and seconded, I think, by Councilor Roberts. Now, Councilor McGinty.
Question probably for the town manager. What's the additional tax implication for this, for these bonds?
Currently, within the municipal budget for the implementation of these projects, there is 64 cents already in the budget for this. The additional impact is 14 cents, or 0.7% tax rate equivalency, 14 cents. A total tax rate impact of 78 cents based on the current valuation.
Catch a question, Councilor McGinty?
64 cents is already in this
64
current.
64 cents. This is,
so we're looking at an additional 14 cents.
It's the equivalency of 14. It might, depending on if there were savings in the budget, otherwise it had been the last couple of years, it might be less. I should point out, too, particularly after the pool issue with some of the cost estimates, the pool, we know the cost now. We still have a healthy contingency that so far has gone fairly well. The public works project still has a full 15% contingency, which is quite high. But after our experience with the pool, I wanted to be sure that we were protected in that regard.
Thank you. Other discussion? Not. Are we ready to move the question? Thank you. All those in favor of the motion is read. I'm not going to read it again.
Could we have the motion read again?
Yes, you can have the motion read. Would you read the motion again, please? The two of them.
Move that the town council authorize expenditure of $2.7 million. 2.7. Mm-hmm. As part of it was in the budget, right? It's the expenditure of $2.7 million for improvements and renovations to the Richards Pool and the issuance of $2.2 million in bonds to finance such expenditure. And authorizing expenditure for $3.5 million for constructing and equipping a new public works facility at the town's Gulf Crest property on Spurwink Road and the issuance of $3.5 million in bonds to finance such expenditure.
Thank you. All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you. The motion carries unanimously. Item number 21, consideration of a recommendation from the trustees of Riverside Cemetery to name roads within the cemetery. Deborah.
Thank you very much. As everyone knows, Riverside Cemetery is undergoing an expansion currently, and I'm glad to say that we are winding down on that project. The roads, the drainage, and all the landscaping have been put in. You may note that the grass over at the cemetery has not taken to the town's liking. It will be mowed this week, and we are in negotiations with the landscaper on what we're going to do this fall to try to get the grass going back, growing on that site. So I've had a lot of questions about that, so I wanted to put that out there. Other than that, the trustees met, and they would like the council to approve the following names for the three roads within the cemetery. Around the flagpole area, they are recommending Lilac Lane, the outer road, Birch Lane, and then the inner road, Maple Lane.
Thank you. Does any councilors have any? We have, let's put a motion on the floor. Someone got the motion on the floor? Yes, Councilor.
I recommend that we accept the names of Birch Lane for the outer road, Maple Lane for the inner road, and Lilac Lane for the road surrounding the flagpole, as the trustees of Riverside Cemetery have suggested.
Second. Second by Councilor Watson.
I think I should go first.
Okay.
Yeah. Although this doesn't trigger our addressing ordinance, by ordinance, these names, I mean, fall directly, we already have a maple down the road here, and to add another maple would be confusing. Same with Birch Lane, but we have Birch Knolls. I mean, I don't think we should compound our 911 addressing problems by adding similar sounding names at this point. I mean, these are benign names. I could support them in a second. But I think it falls. We already have names in there that sound like Linden Lane in there, which is like Lindenwood or whatever. I mean, we got enough problems with changing names now, street names. I don't think we should compound our problem by adding these names to the cemetery. And I mean, I would recommend we send this back to them and ask them for some different names, appropriate names.
Thank you. I'm going to ask, Mr. Emery, did you have something you wanted to say, which is, this is not a public hearing, but we'd love to have your comments.
Excuse me, Madam Chair. As Tom Emery, 12 Juniper Lane, as a resident of Brentwood, of North Brentwood East, the street into which Juniper Lane intersects is Maple Lane. And I only brought that up while I was sitting here. I happened to read this and discovered that. So I wanted to be sure either, one, in case of an emergency, I wasn't delivered to Riverside Cemetery, or when I need to go to Riverside Cemetery, I'm not dropped off on the Maple Lane now. So.
Leave it to the rescue.
Well, Councilor Roberts.
Madam Chairman, I'm not opposed to sending it back for other names. However, I doubt that very many of the residents over there are really going to be calling 911 in the near future. I have no problem sending it back.
Well, we've had rescue calls over there, believe it or not. I mean, and yes, so.
Madam Chair, I would withdraw my second and suggest that Anne maybe amend her her motion.
Any other comments? I hadn't realized the duplication in the names, and upon hearing it, I think there might indeed be some confusion. It sounds funny, but there might be somebody visiting a cemetery plot over there who had a heart attack, and I could see that it might be confusing. So I'd like to amend my motion that we send this back to the trustees and ask them to come up with some new names that are not as confusing.
Second.
Well, just for the record, I personally don't have any problem with these names, but we will certainly, yes, Debbie.
The trustees, who the chairman, Milton Hollowell, is here this evening, we talked about that, and because they're not formal streets, we really didn't think it would be a problem. It's not that the trustees didn't realize that there might be a duplication. They tried to keep in keeping with the other roads. There are linden trees on Linden Lane, maple, birch, lilacs, all made sense. So they were, certainly did discuss that, and I just didn't want to let that go without you knowing that they were aware of it, but we really didn't think it would be an issue.
All right, the motion on the table is to send this back to the trustees. All those in favor? All those opposed? Five to two. Just another step in bureaucratic government here, moving along through the committees. Thought I could avoid it. Item number 22, consideration of proposed carry-forward balances from the fiscal year 1999. In your packet, you will see, I'll turn this over to the manager, you'll see item number 22. Thank you. I guess you've got it in your packet. Okay, Michael.
Yeah. This is a relatively standard list. Although we're doing it a month later than usual, which is good because we know that the different balances. I'll highlight a few of these just to make it interesting, I suppose. There have been a couple of reclassifications. For example, we had some money in there for special studies. I changed the title to Tower Studies because that's what it's being spent on. So, you know, the same amount of money for special studies, special activities, but it's changed to Tower Studies. Hazardous materials collection, $14,779. In the budget this past year, the council appropriated $15,000. Regional Waste Systems did it for us instead. We didn't have an expense. We don't know if they're going to be continuing that into succeeding years. It's on this list because the staff is recommending that if they don't do it, we step in and do it for a second year. There was a little bit of money spent for getting rid of some hazardous material that we had on our own. It didn't go through the project. That's why it dropped 15 to 4779. Spurring Church weather vane and siding. This is, we had a lot of money this past year that we spent on the roof. There's some siding repairs, and the one thing that we really noted is the weather vane needs to be re-gold leafed. And I was amazed when we get the estimate to do it, it was not anywhere near. I thought we might have been looking at tens of thousands of dollars, because when you see it, it's up close, it's huge. But it was actually very reasonable. And that's what that item is, would re-gold leaf the weather vane as well as do some repairs to the siding. All of these are legitimate carry-forward balances, and with one exception, which I feel obligated to point out. The roadway improvement account actually didn't have that much money left in it. However, I want to carry forward that much money because this would enable us to complete the paving of Mitchell Road, which we ran out of money to do last year. This would continue from the entrance to Cranbrook all the way to the South Portland line. And the reason I'm suggesting that is because the road's in terrible shape, because we started it, we've gotten a lot of complaints, and because of the legislature recently adopted a new local road assistance program in which during this coming year we'll be getting about $20,000 more than we got during the previous year. So what I did is I added about $20,000 to the amount that we would have carried forward, recognizing that we'll be getting that additional money this year, and that you know, the citizens should see their gas tax increase money really going into improving local roads, which was the intent. So that's the reason for the increase. Beyond that, all of these are carry forwards, and I'd be happy to answer any question on any of them. I do that. I call them reverse appropriations, Councilor Pagenti. I've done it before.
I just don't know how we can carry forward money that we don't have.
I go back. That's why I put the charter definition up here. That all general shall lapse at the close of the fiscal year to the extent that it has not been expended or encumbered, except an appropriation for capital expenditure shall not lapse until the purpose of which it was made is accomplished or abandoned. We haven't accomplished the project that we intended to accomplish, which was to pave all of Mitchell Road. And we do have monies in overall in the entire budget in order to accommodate this, so we'd be lapsing it, you know, sort of into that account, and then
we're kind of taking it from undesignated surplus to surplus.
That's right. That's right. Okay. I was trying to look at a creative way of getting something done that needed to be done.
Oh, I support the project. I just
I'd like to entertain a motion. Having our discussion before the motion here.
Madam Chair, I make a motion that we extend these balances into the next fiscal year.
Second.
Second, it's been Councilor, I don't know who seconded it. Thank you very much. Is there any further discussion on this item? All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you. Item number 23, did they get that on a separate piece of paper?
On a separate piece of paper.
Okay. This has been announced properly. It's just on a separate piece of paper here. Action upon public hearing comments on proposed updates of the fire protection, the prevention ordinance, the construction ordinance, and the zoning ordinance.
Yeah, I will very briefly, and then Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, is here. This is the famous packet that you kept being asked to bring back because it's so thick. We do have one additional technical amendment, which was on white paper. On your podium this evening. And let me go over that since it is new to the town council. There is a provision in the section of the zoning ordinance having to do with critical wetlands, resource protection areas, wetland buffers, etc., that provides that if there was a subdivision that was approved after December 22, 1976, and particularly a lot of these show building envelopes where buildings are to go, that they have until May 10 of 2000 to substantially complete the building, the shed, the addition, whatever it is. The looking at the definition there and at the bottom, it defined that it needed to be substantially complete as meaning deemed satisfied upon issuance of a certificate of occupancy. The real difficulty with that is in the practical application of it, if there is a building that is under construction and it's 90% completed, but some fire code issue is there, we would have to say you have to stop construction, that's it. There's nothing in the ordinance at all that allows us to do anything further. In reviewing this with the code enforcement officer and with the town planner, the standard that's now used throughout the zoning ordinance is that we use in timing as a date the issuance of when a valid building permit is issued. That's a set date. We can avoid very expensive litigation. I should also mention that the town also does have a particular interest in this, in that we have a lot that we're in the process of selling for $75,000 down in Park Circle, and this would affect that lot. So, you know, we could have a situation where we sell it, someone begins to build on it, and then if for whatever reason there's not a certificate of occupancy, then we have to tell them to stop. And unfortunately, because, you know, we've really just become aware of the fact that this substantial completion means deemed satisfied upon issuance of building permit, we don't really know how many other lots this affects. So we really want to spend some time informing all the citizenry of this so that we don't get people screaming at the council next June, next July, saying, you know, we didn't know about this. The code enforcement officer stopped construction. And, you know, then we said, well, the code enforcement officer is going to be reasonable. He's not going to close anyone down when it's 85%. You know, Bruce Smith is reasonable, and yet he has a duty and obligation to enforce the ordinance. Plus, when anyone points out, if that should be the case, they didn't want to see something happen, and it happened, then it would cause real problems. So, you know, we've reviewed it at the staff level. We don't think this is substantive because it has the same intent. It's closing it as of May 10. It's just closing it in a way that's enforceable rather than, I think, you know, Bruce's comment here, which I quoted from his memo, that the current system may create an enforcement dilemma for the town, and we believe it would. So we feel the town could potentially save lots of litigation, and that this is very much a customer-friendly provision, is to include this and to adopt it with the rest of the package. But we do need a public hearing on this, but I wanted to make sure everyone was aware of this proposal.
Is that what we're going to do here, set the public hearing date?
No, it's tonight, the public hearing.
Madam Chair, my only concern is that May 10th may not give us enough time. Here it is July. You know, I'd like to see us extended to September. I mean, so that we've got a full year of time frame on this issue versus 9 months.
I don't think that's a substantive change. Would that be substantive, do you think, Maureen? Yeah, Maureen's shaking that it might be. We could come back between now and then, you know, after we get a sense of how many homes are involved and whatever. But in the meantime, you know, we'd be encouraging people, you're doing something, get the building permit now or before May 10th. And this doesn't give them the ability to go on forever because they need to keep the building permit current and have continuing activity. So it's not a carte blanche to go on forever, come in and get a building permit.
Well, the way I read this, it says that these newer approved subdivisions must be substantially complete with a certificate of occupancy by May 10th, 2000. Right. That's very different from their starting construction.
It is in terms of, yes, it is. And that's, we're looking for something that is more enforceable, which is the valid building permit. Because we can, after that, we can stop a, you know, you can't get the permit, sorry, but we can't, with a straight face, maybe we can say, you know, your house is 90% complete, you got to stop. We just yeah. feel that would be an untenable situation.
Yeah. I'd like to say extended.
Mm-hmm. You done, is that you through? Okay. Councilor Roberts?
What type of a notification will people receive? Just a public notice in the paper, or will you try to identify who this might apply to?
We had a discussion of that today, and the intent would be to review all of the subdivisions that have been approved since December of 1976, to then do an analysis of all those that have a critical wetland buffer that might be affected, and to send notices to all those folks indicating that if they're planning to do any of these things, they would need to have a valid building permit by May 10th of 2000.
Councilor Swift-Cayetta.
How long does a valid building permit stay valid? I mean, if you apply before May 10th or any certain deadline, what do you have to do to make it still be valid?
You need to be continually working on it over a six-month period. And is it 2 years beyond that?
18 months.
18 months? It's in the BOCA code.
18 months.
18 months that you need to complete it. You can, I think, renew it for 1 year, is it, John?
It says, the work is not commenced within 6 months after issuance, or the authorized work is suspended or abandoned for a period of 6 months. If the work is not substantially completed within 18 months, then he can deem the permit expired.
Okay, thank you.
Our hope is that within the next 2 months, we would do all the notification. And then, you know, I think to respond to Councilor Watson's comments is, you know, if we begin to hear some issues, then there would be an opportunity for the council to address it either by an emergency enactment or otherwise.
I need to open a public hearing on this item. If there are citizens here to discuss the technical amendments part of this meeting, are there any citizens here that wish to speak on these issues? If not, then we'll close the public hearing and we'll move on to discussion if there's any more discussion from the council. I was going to open the public hearing before discussion, but I didn't get to it.
Madam Chair, I just want to make sure I understand. If I vote in support of this, then I'm voting for the May 10th, 2000. If I don't vote to support this, then it just, there isn't any extension? Is that what I'm understanding?
It would be, no, it would remain in effect that they need to have a certificate of occupancy by May 10, 2000 if you voted against this. There would be no change. This gives them the, if you included this, this gives them the right to get a building permit by then. If you, that's by voting yes, you give them the right to have a building permit. If you voted no, they'd have to have a certificate of occupancy by May 10, 2000 on this particular portion of it. Then, of course, there's the rest of the ordinance. Yeah.
So, but then we could vote again to vote for a later date?
You could do that, but you would want to go through the normal procedure of coming up with a proposal, referring it to the planning board, have them have a public hearing, but go back to the council. The council have a public hearing, or declare an emergency, and then it only remains in effect for 90 days, mm-hmm. which would have the effect then of extending it from May 10th for 90 days.
No.
But we'll have a much better handle, I'd say, in 2 months of how many lots this affects and the significance of it. But in the shorter term, and you know, in quite frankly, with the desirability of a lot, our lot sale would probably fall through if this provision was not in place, and the land acquisition fund would be out $75,000. No, it would be out the balance of $75,000 after all the taxes have been paid.
Well, it should be such that it would be noted by the planning board that we have some concern about the May 10th, 2000 deadline, and they might take that under consideration, I would think.
Yeah, we will, just as soon as we can. We've got a lot of other projects ongoing with historic preservation and planning board and whatever, but we'll do the towers. We'll do just as soon as we can of preparing the list and know how serious the problem could be. Okay.
Does anybody wish to hear from Maureen? Do you have any you're not volunteering any comments? Okay.
If anyone from the citizens want copies of that technical amendment.
Do you have something to say?
Against my better judgment. There was some concern about the date, and I just wanted to give you a little bit of background. That date was established 10 years ago. And it's the longest grandfathering period I think I've ever seen in any ordinance. Mm-hmm. And what you're proposing to do tonight, what we've done is we've put together a package of technical amendments, and we call them technical amendments because the theory is that we're really not making any big changes. There's some really minor policy changes, and most of them are just clarifying what we already are doing. And what the manager is proposing with this change is that when we adopted the new zoning ordinance in 1997, there was a lot of language in there that talked about requiring someone to be substantially complete and putting the date. Well, that's a very vague date, and it requires a subjective judgment by a code enforcement officer, which is very difficult to defend in court. So what we tried to do, the intent of the zoning ordinance when it looks at building permit dates is always to encourage people to complete their project. The worst thing for a community is to have a project stop or stall midway. You have a half-constructed building. So we're still trying to get at the same goal, which is to have people start construction and end or complete construction in a timely manner and leave the site in a safe condition. And all this is doing is relieving the code enforcement officer from the undesirable duty of having to tell someone to stop building on their site when they're partially complete. And that, I don't think that serves anyone in the community. What this does instead is really bring this portion of the ordinance into compliance and consistency with those newer portions of the ordinance, where almost everything we've done is tied to the building permit issuance. So this gives people a little bit more time in terms of that date, but I would really point to it more as an effort to make the zoning ordinance more consistent.
Thank you. Does the council understand the motion? Councilor McGinty, we are making a motion to accept the technical amendments package, the big thick package that you've been carrying around, plus this last one. Let me just have the discussion.
Is there such a motion on the floor yet?
No, there is not.
I'll make that motion.
Thank you.
I'll second that motion.
That's it? You're going to make the motion?
I'll second
that. Was it.
Okay, you seconded it?
I seconded it.
Fine. Is there any further discussion? Fine. All those in favor? Any opposed? No, it carries unanimously. Thank you very much. That concludes the regular meeting of the town council. We will be, where are we here? Here we are. I'll entertain a motion for adjournment. Oh, is there any citizens discussion? See, we have a new citizen that's arrived. Are there any citizens discussion not on the agenda? Okay. The agenda's over for tonight, then. Thank you. I'll entertain a motion for adjournment.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor? Thank you.
Just before the mic is off, you do have a workshop on
Thursday.
Tonight, discussing the Ralph Gould Award.
Oh, tonight. You saw that at the bottom of your agenda. Right.
Okay. Take them.
Have a quick minute.